video is electrifying, in a curious sort of way.
There are more things in heaven and earth, Horatio, than dreamt of in your philosophy. Hamlet.
If you want to find the secrets of the universe, think in terms of energy, frequency, and vibration. Nikola Tesla.
In the little house where the pixies live, imagination, inquisitiveness, and outside-the-box thinking are embraced as the very spark of life. A well-defined, eternal sense of wonder and curiosity are the stuff that propels innovation, and in the little house, these traits are not quashed, but rather encouraged. As a result of this environment, if you happen to wonder aloud in the presence of a pixie, you are likely to find yourself engaged forthwith in an experiment to challenge your set notions and expand your understanding of whatever the subject matter of your inadvertent mutterings. There are always little ears listening and little minds ready to investigate new mysteries. It was in this way that the experiment in electroculture sprang to life in the Pixies Potager. Electroculture is simply the harnessing of atmospheric energy, or ether, and the magnetic resonance of the earth through the use of basic tools such as copper wire antennas and magnets, and applying these to the growth of plants through a variety of methods which revitalize the soil, stimulate microbial activity, and direct frequencies that alert the plants to open their stomatas to absorb minerals, all of which increases the plant's growth and yield through increased sap flow and nutrient uptake. At least, that's the theory. The theory is not a new one, snatched from the aforementioned ether by mystical storytellers or fanciful plant enthusiasts. Rather, its roots are firmly planted in the scientific field. The 18th century was a busy time for everyone. The Sun King, Louis XIV, finally ceased his pursuit to dominate the continent through endless warfare. Johann Sebastian Bach and Mozart arrived to fill the world with inspired musical genius. And Captain Baring, a Dane employed by Russia, looked out his window and discovered Alaska, or something like that. The first newspaper in America was published, followed by Benjamin Franklin's famous Poor Richard's Almanac, which was then promptly followed by a lawsuit of libel against a New York publisher, which ended in an acquittance and the establishment of the freedom of the press. Some things are timeless. Since Louis had given up on world dominance, Britain and Prussia stepped in to soundly defeat everyone else on the continent. Having bolstered their morale and now feeling their oats, Britain quickly headed out to colonize India and capture Quebec from the French, while beginning an industrial revolution at home. Unsatisfied with angering only a majority of the civilized world, Britain then imposed the Stamp Act on America, followed by British troops firing on citizens of Boston who were protesting the English taxes. Bostonians promptly marched down to the harbor to toss crates of English tea into the drink in protest of taxation, and setting up Americans' future obsession with coffee and the ultimate embracing of the $7 coffee drink hawked by chic West Coast coffee purveyors. Englishmen around the globe gasped in scandalized horror. Another revolution was begun, this time in America. No one messes with the English tea and walks away unscathed. A document declaring independence was signed by angry and determined English expats, and a new country was soon born. George Washington was elected president of the newly formed United States in a unanimous vote in Congress, marking the last time the government bodies ever agreed entirely on anything. In the midst of the chaotic century, Mr. Mainbray of Edinburgh stepped out and experimented with the harnessing of electricity to affect plant growth by electrifying two myrtle trees in the month of October, who, in reaction, quickly put out new branches and blossoms before any of the other unelectrified trees of the same genus. Abbé Nollet, a French Catholic deacon and a scientist whose main area of study was electricity, learned of Mr. Mainbray's experiment and was induced to try it himself. Abbé Nollet's fame was to be in the discovery of osmosis, though not necessarily in the understanding of the mechanism. The recording of these events in Jason Priestley's History and Present State of Electricity, published in 1767, was the very first introduction of the subject of electroculture. In France, in the latter part of the 18th century, research was being done with water impregnated with electrical fluid, which sped up the germination of seeds and bulbs. Pierre Berthelon went further in implementing the first electroculture tool, the electrovegetometer. Berthelon set up a miniature lightning conductor to gather electricity from the atmosphere and distribute it throughout his garden via a network of wires. In 1844, a Scottish landowner, Robert Forster, boosted his barley yield so substantially through the use of atmospheric energy that it earned him a write-up in the 1845 March edition of the British Cultivator. In 1880, a Swedish professor and geophysicist studying the Northern Lights began experimenting with atmospheric energy based on his observations that trees in the far north grew more rapidly than those further south, despite the short growing season. After collaborating with other scientists in both Sweden and Germany, Professor Lindström published Electricity in Agriculture and Horticulture in 1904, where he elaborated on the favorable influence that electricity had on increasing harvest and even changing the sweetness and aroma of the plants which he had treated. In the early 1900s, between the two Great Wars, the British government ran a secret experiment to determine whether or not they might be able to boost the yields of crops using electroculture, and while it showed impressive results, the results were also deemed erratic. The project was ultimately abandoned, and the records, which held surprisingly positive data in favor of the use of electroculture in boosting food production, were archived and marked not for publication to the public. A rather strange response for a hypothetically failed trial. Meanwhile, in France, Justin Christoflot, an engineer and inventor, set about attempting to do away with the need for any chemical fertilizer while still increasing his garden's growth. In his Potager Electrique, he experimented with electromagnetic tyro-celestial energy. He traveled the world lecturing on his experiments and their results, and patented several devices in relation to electroculture. The agro sector was not amused, and they let their feelings be known. The Second World War closed the factories that were producing Christoflot's devices, and that was that. Following World War II, chemical fertilizers and pesticides were king in the ag business, and large farming methods leaned into the new ideology of better things for living through chemistry, advertised by the DuPont Company. But there has remained a fringe minority of interest in the almost forgotten experiments of electroculture in potagers around the world. Recently, scientists in China have been experimenting on large scale with electroculture in greenhouses and have written their impressive results and the potential for electroculture to increase food yields in the journal Nature Food. A new wave of budding electroculture enthusiasts have begun to experiment in their own home garden and backyard potagers, creating antennas from copper wire shaped into spirals which mimic nature in their design. Placing these antennas in their garden beds, potted plants, and fields, they're experimenting with capturing the energy all around us to revitalize the soil and reduce plant pests. When we first heard about this old technology, it captured our imagination immediately. The use of antennas to pull frequencies out of the atmosphere, which open the stomatas of the plant and allow it to uptake nutrients more efficiently, was intriguing. Using a helix shape found constantly throughout nature to create a more effective transfer of energy was also interesting. The Pixies were all in. Worst case scenario, we were out a few dollars for copper wire, and nothing came of it. No harm, no foul. And so we set out to Home Depot to acquire the necessary materials to test this new hypothesis that by spiraling copper up wooden stakes and adding them to only particular plants in our potager, the growth and yield would somehow be increased in those plants as compared to the control plants with no antennas. It should be noted that pixies are enthusiastic scientists, and no amount of delays in finding a Home Depot employee certified in operating the wire by foot machine and trained in the cutting thereof would deter them from their mission. When an individual who fit all the aforementioned criteria was at last cornered and unable to escape without helping us, wire was at last acquired, and the golden pixie only managed one hard stare for the unwitting cashier before being unable to hold on to her disapproval of their customer service grimace and instead bestowed her normally sunny smile on the completely innocent cashier and affirmed aloud what a good job she was doing. The bemused woman smiled back and laughingly thanked her, and off we went with our newly purchased wire finally in hand. At home, fallen branches were collected and turned into antennas for the lucky baby tomato plants that had been chosen to receive them. Because we are in the northern hemisphere, it is commonly advised that the copper wire be wrapped from the base of the stake clockwise up to the top and a portion be left above the tip as the antenna. So this is what we did. However, because we can never stay completely within the lines, it occurred to me that it might be interesting to experiment with a tepee support wrapped in a helix of copper, clockwise of course. More than once, we found ourselves having to unwind our wire and then rewind to our other clockwise. We also had a couple cucumbers that seemed interested in the tomatoes' new digs, so we constructed a couple more spiral teepees and moved the baby cukes right in. In the meantime, we discovered the idea of copper collars with an opening on one side where the two ends of the copper wire overlap each other but do not touch. "Like a necklace for the plants," exclaimed the golden pixie with delight. "How can that go wrong?" So collars were made and put around a few chosen pepper plant stems. Golden Pixie engaged the use of her compass in orienting the ring's opening to the south, but soon tired of it and decided she had a pretty good handle on which direction south was, and carried on without it. Within a couple weeks, there was a surprising and noticeable difference in the growth of plants which were adorned with collars or in the midst of a copper vortex. The difference was so great, as compared to the control plants, that the pixies made a case on behalf of the unfortunate no-copper class of the plant community and talked me into expanding antennas and collars to a broader swath of the leafy folk in the potager, with a couple of exceptions, which I was allowed to keep unadorned for continued observation and comparison. The golden pixie raised a single fair eyebrow in concern for the observation group, but accepted her victory on behalf of the majority and moved on. Squash plants seemed ambivalent towards the copper antennas, while beans, cucumbers, tomatoes, and peppers embraced their finery and grew with exceptional speed. Pumpkin plants found a new vigor and began racing across the garden paths to peek into other garden beds curiously, and a single strawberry plant with its own little antenna attempted to set a record for setting lovely berries nonstop, a situation we had never seen in our garden before, and this plant in particular had never produced one edible berry last season. The tomato plant inside the copper vortex tepee shot up to the top of the tepee in March, completely unfazed by the last freeze of the season, and happily produced mass amounts of black cherry tomatoes which dangled from her branches like so many jewels. The unadorned tomatoes planted at the same time took another 6 weeks to decide if they would grow or just give up and wither away. With enough coaxing and the Golden Pixie's elixir of life, otherwise known as Fox Farm's Grow Big and Epsom salt, in a watering pot, the tomatoes were convinced to hold on to life and eventually began to grow again. Along with the obvious increase in growth and early production of the leafy specimens in the potager, an impressive number of dragonflies, bees, butterflies, and even furry folk have come to hang out around the antennas. The cats like to lay next to them and for some odd reason bite the copper wires ever so gently. Dragonflies, which were non-existent in last year's potager, are often found posing pridefully on the top of antennas like fancy ornaments, a circumstance that has also delighted the feline folk. The Golden Pixie thought the addition of some pretty quartz stones to the top of her antennas would be just the thing. After all, who doesn't feel a little more sparkly with a bit of bling, even a potager? And after seeing her handiwork put in place, well, she was right. In the end, there is so much we don't know, so much mystery and wonder in every part of our remarkable universe. How this newly old technology works is still under investigation by those scientists open-minded enough and brave enough to challenge entrenched paradigms. While there are many who would be quick to dismiss experiments in electroculture and declare it a pseudoscience, I have found throughout years of research and writing that many of the previous pseudoscientific ideas that have been quashed over the centuries and which led to the ostracizing and destroying of scientists and individuals who dare to challenge the consensus have been proven not only valid, but imperative in the expansion of human understanding of the world in which we live. But whether the copper coils work on the soil microbes and plants through transference of frequencies, very low voltage electricity, cymatics, or even something we haven't yet identified, it all remains such a curious question, awaiting exploration. In the little house where the pixies live, the experiments continue as we imagine new ideas to test, new limits to challenge, and new discoveries to be uncovered, at least new to us. We continue to learn from others and to observe our own experience with an open-minded enthusiasm. Because we cannot explain something, it does not detract from the results, simply makes us more determined to solve the mysteries all around us. So grab a bit of single-strand copper wire, a stick, and your own observation of nature's designs, and come along with us on our adventure. Your inner suppressed scientist will thank you. Thank you for watching. See you next time.
The Lord made the earth by his power, and he preserves it by his wisdom. With his own understandings, he stretched out the heavens. Jeremiah 51:15.